Morning, church. Welcome to Woodcrest. I'd like to invite you to stand as you're able, worship with us this morning. Let's sing Joy to the World.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing.
Stronger than the power of First, to wish you a very Merry Christmas this first Sunday of December. So I'm just curious, and you don't have to do this by a show of hands because you might be the only one that would raise your hand. Has anybody got all their Christmas shopping done already? Oh, wow, there are a few. Actually, no hands, but a few heads nod. I am very, very impressed. You know, I went into Target yesterday to find a personal thing that I needed, and I couldn't find it, and then I thought, well, I've got some Christmas gifts I need to buy, so I left Target with four items I could check off my gift list for Christmas, and so it was a productive Saturday. You know, we sometimes get so focused on the birth of Christ at Christmas time, and rightly so. We're going to do that this December, but the celebration of the Lord's Supper at this time of the year is really, really significant, for it summarizes, it draws our attention to why Jesus came, to give his life on a cross. And so I don't think there's another time of the year that it's as appropriate it is as Christmas to celebrate the Lord's Supper. You know, I had a chance to connect with Jason Maloney this past week. If you're new to Woodcrest, you may not recognize that name, but Jason used to be on staff here as one of our pastors. He's now serving a church in Lakeville. It was so good to connect. And as pastors, we were kind of sharing our December thoughts, what our churches were doing and what we were preaching on. And he shared that they were doing something really cool at their church. They're preparing cake mixes to give to all their families to make a birthday cake for Jesus at Christmas time. And I thought, that's a really, really cool idea. And we're not going to do that this year. We got some other things that we're doing here this Thanksgiving. I thought, that is so cool. I mean, with all of the preoccupation with gift giving this time of the year, we should probably be focused a little bit about the gifts that we give to Jesus. Because it's his birthday that we're celebrating, correct? And so I think that it's a rightful time to think about what could we give Jesus. And, you know, giving gifts to Jesus has biblical precedence. You're familiar with the story of the Magi who came to give extravagant gifts to the Christ child. And so it has a biblical precedence. So I was thinking about what gift I might give to Jesus this year, or what gift I might challenge you to give Jesus this year. And here's what I came up with for my own life, and I want to challenge you about this. I sense God asking me to give him the gift of repentance. Of repentance. Not just a confession of a sin, but a radical 180-degree turn from some stronghold in my life. Something that I wrestle with way too often. To do a 180-degree turn and say, Lord, this Christmas, my gift is to change the way I do that. John wrote in his first letter, if we confess our sins, God is what? He's faithful to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so I want to encourage you this morning, make that your theme as we celebrate the Lord's Supper. In just a moment, I'm going to invite you to come forward to receive the elements. This month, we're just going to ask you to partake when you're ready, when you've had the moment of reflection that you need. And come with a theme of what could you give Jesus this year? What gift could you give him? And maybe it is the gift of repentance, a change in your life regarding a broken relationship. Maybe there's an addiction. Maybe there's a stronghold in your life that you need to say, Lord, this Christmas I want to give this up and I want to turn from that. Maybe you struggle with anger or lust or gossip or another one of the deadly sins. And you say, Lord, at the cross this Christmas I give you the gift of repentance. I confess my sin and I want to make a change. Whatever your area is, I encourage you to think about that as you come to receive the elements this morning. Let me pray and then I'll invite you to do that. Father, I thank you that you set the pace when it came to the giving of gifts, the gift of your son Jesus, who came to give his life as a ransom for us. And as we've just sang, he came to pay a debt, and through the paying of that debt, we see a love that is forever faithful. So as we come to the table this morning to receive the elements, may our hearts be challenged to give you the gift of change, the gift of repentance, the gift of confession. And we say thank you, thank you, thank you, that if we confess, you're faithful to forgive us again and again. In Jesus' name we pray.
You're the reason we came to encounter you.
like to invite everyone to stand once again. See, in the Bible it says, where two or more are gathered in His name, He is there. I believe He's there this morning. And this is exactly what heaven's going to be like. We're worshiping Him all together. Not a care in the world, but just us and God. And we get to praise Him for all of eternity. And every single Sunday, we have the opportunity to practice that. We get to practice for heaven every single Sunday and worship together. And we can look around and see a room full of worshipers. And I think that's just beautiful. So with the rest of this song, let's just imagine what it's like in heaven and worship together. Let's sing Spirit of God. Be seated.
Is about to change forever. A day of reckoning. A decree from on high. A time to be counted. A world ruled by an iron fist. Just when people needed hope, God would send a baby, a king, to offer a foretaste of a better future. But why? Why was a virgin chosen to be the mother of Jesus? Why would an earthly man be chosen to raise a baby sent from heaven? I choose the lowliest of men to be the first to see the newborn King. Why did kings come from the east to worship the King of the Jews? Why Bethlehem? And perhaps the most important question, why should we care? And what should the baby in Bethlehem mean to me? Though many years have gone by, and that stable in Bethlehem is long gone, we need to concentrate our gaze through the midst of time, through the lens of Scripture, and use our imagination, not to change the Christmas story, but envision the people, places, and circumstances that could have been a part of the Nativity. And in doing so, we will answer the mystery, the meaning, and the question, why the Nativity?
Every year, we sing songs about it. We adorn our homes with scenes and reminders of it. We greet strangers with its glad tidings. And even a world ignorant of its purpose celebrates its remembrance. It's Christmas, the time of year when we rejoice in the earthly coming of Jesus Christ. It's the season when much of the world stands still at the celebration of this, the most significant event in all of human history. But even as believers, how often do we really focus our attention on this remarkable story? If we're truly honest, the answer is not very often. Instead, we spend Christmas time shopping for presents for those we love, cooking meals for family gatherings, and decorating our homes with festive lights and ornaments. Now, should we regret these holiday traditions that we share with those nearest and dearest to us? Of course not. Christmas is a wonderful time to embrace the blessings of our families and our love for one another. I'm getting a little bit of an echo, guys. Just a little bit. Thank you. However, in the midst of these activities, we need to take the time to remember what Christmas is really all about and just why it had to happen the way it did. There's so much to this story. There's so much more to this story than just the birth of a child in Bethlehem. This was a moment of fulfillment. This was the culmination of hundreds of years of prophecy. From Genesis to Isaiah to Micah, the Old Testament is filled with prophecies concerning the Messiah. And these ancient words regarded not only his coming, but also the manner of his coming, the location of his birth, his ancestry, his life, and even his death. This is a story that started in the Garden of Eden, paused at a cross and an empty tomb, and will culminate one day in his glorious return. But Christmas is also a story about God's people, about their need for a Savior, about their need for a sacrifice that would cover their sins forever. So this is a story about salvation. And although God supernaturally and sovereignly orchestrated every detail in the birth of his son, the Christmas story is filled with fascinating human profiles and personalities. Imagine being Mary, a virgin carrying the Son of God. Imagine being Joseph, her loyal and faithful husband. Imagine experiencing the visitation of angels sent by God. Wrapped in the shroud of this holy mystery are some very human emotions. And then there are scenes worthy of a cinematic experience. The Messiah, the King of Kings, is born in an outdoor manger. And the first to come and worship him are lowly, dirty shepherds, the outcasts of society. And up above, a magnificent star illuminates the heaven, leading a cast of magi to come and see the child. This is the truest drama ever witnessed. And friends, this is the greatest plot ever written. And that's why I'm so excited about this year's Christmas sermon series, Why the Nativity. And we're going to use clips from the just-released movie by the same name each week. And we'll search the scriptures to explore the compelling reasons why it's so important that we celebrate the Nativity. And to do this, we're going to examine five questions as to why this one moment in time, the birth of this Christ child, was the pivotal moment of all time, and that it was assembled in such a way that we can only say it was the work of God. Let's pray as we start this journey together. Father, the story of the birth of your Son is as familiar to us as any story there is. I pray this Christmas, Christmas 2022, that it would come alive to us in a new and fresh way as we answer some of the compelling reasons. Why the Nativity? Why did you send your Son? Why did he came? Why Mary? Why Joseph? Why wise men? And I pray that this Christmas would be different and more meaningful than any Christmas we've ever had before. In Jesus' name, amen. Can you imagine how Mary must have felt as she gazed at her newborn child? Now, any child that's born is a miracle from heaven, but this child was a special gift from heaven. This child had been set apart from any other that had ever been born in the history of the world. But why? Why? The angel Gabriel had spoken directly to Mary with the answer. Luke chapter 1, verse 35. The angel said, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy," the what? The Son of God. Though this angelic visit challenged Mary's ability to believe it in her head, the scriptures indicate that the heart of this special young girl confirmed that what the angel had said was true. This child that she held was indeed the Son of God. And yet, Mary must have had questions as well, don't you think? Can't you imagine the questions she would have had? Such as, why did God's Son become a human? And I think as we look at our first of five compelling why the Nativity questions this week, there are four answers to that important question, why Jesus became a human being. The first answer to the question of why did Jesus become a man was to satisfy the prophecies of the Old Testament. Later, near the end of his earthly life, this is what we read in Luke chapter 24, verse 44. Then he said to him, to them, Jesus said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." They must be completed. They must be brought to completion. Everything said about Jesus in the Old Testament had to be fulfilled in his coming. Do you know, do you realize that it's possible to write a thorough Christology, meaning a theology about Jesus, using only the Old Testament prophecies about him? You could complete your doctrine of Jesus simply by what the Old Testament prophesies about him. The prophets spoke frequently about a coming Messiah, a champion for the people of Israel and for the world. Every page from Genesis all the way to Malachi drips with the wondrous anticipation of the coming of the Savior. The prophetic books were written by many different writers at various times over many centuries, and yet throughout the words of the prophets, there were glimmers of a Savior who would rescue his people and restore them to God. In fact, there are more than 300 specific prophecies in the Hebrew scriptures about the promised Messiah. And the hints were tantalizing, and they were everywhere. Isaiah said that this special deliverer would be born of a virgin and that his name would be called what? Emmanuel. And what's so amazing is that Isaiah wrote this not 1 year before it happened, not 10 years before, but hundreds of years before it took place. The prophet Micah offered a prediction about Jesus that was both specific and startling. The actual location of his birth and that he would come from the distant past. We remember this familiar prophecy in Micah chapter 5, verse 2. But you, O Bethlehem Ephratah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days. Jeremiah prophesied that the birthplace of this coming Messiah would suffer a massacre of infants. That's how specific these Old Testament prophecies were. And we see in Matthew's first Christmas narrative the tragic fulfillment of this prophecy. The story is found for us in Matthew chapter 2, beginning in verse 16. Then Herod, when he saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, became furious, and he sent and killed the male children in Bethlehem and in all that region who were 2 years of old, 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had ascertained from the wise men. Then was fulfilled what was spoken by the prophet Jeremiah. A voice was heard in Ramah, weeping and loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be comforted because they are no more. Friends, hundreds of years before he was born, prophets foretold the coming of the Messiah, the Anointed One, who would redeem God's people. In effect, these Old Testament prophecies created a fingerprint that only the true Messiah could fit. And against astronomical odds, defined by numbers that we can't even begin to wrap our minds around, like 1 in 83 billion, Jesus and Jesus only matched the prophetic fingerprint of God. That's why the Nativity. That's why the Nativity. Another reason Jesus came as a man was to show us the Father. He came to fulfill Old Testament prophecy, and he also came to show us the Father. On a starlit night, in the company of sheep, cattle, and a bewildered Joseph, Mary's eyes fell upon the face of her just-born son. She was likely in pain and bone-weary, probably wishing she could just lay her head down and sleep the night away. But first, Mary had to see this face, his face. And I can imagine that she whispered, "So this is what God looks like. This is what God looks like." You know, people have always wondered about the image of God. Since the beginning of time, societies have speculated, and humans have reached a variety of strange conclusions. God's been depicted as a golden calf, a violent wind, and an angry volcano. He wears wings, breathes fires, eats infants, and demands penance. We fancied him as ferocious, magical, fickle, and maniacal, a God to be avoided, dreaded, and appeased. But never in mankind's wild imagination did we ever consider that God would enter the world as an infant. But that's just what happened. John, in his gospel story of the Christmas narrative, he doesn't share very much with us, but this is what he says in John chapter 1, verse 14. And the Word became what? Became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. So you see, the Word became not a whirlwind or a devouring fire, but a single cell, a fertilized egg, an embryo, a baby. I don't know if you ever thought about this, but placenta nourished him. There was an amniotic sac around him. He grew into the size of a fist, and then his tiny heart divided into chambers. God became flesh. Friends, Jesus entered the world not like a human, but as a human. Why? To show us the Father. To show us the Father. Now, during Jesus' earthly ministry, one day Philip was talking with him, and he said this to Jesus, "Lord, show us the Father, and it's enough for us." And Jesus answered him, answered Philip, "Have I been with you so long, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father." Jesus was God in human body. So if you want to know who God is, guess what? You need to know who Jesus is. Because Jesus teaches you who God is. When you see Jesus doing what he did in the Gospels, you're watching God at work. You want to know Jesus? You want to know God? Then you got to get to know Jesus. That's why the only way you can become a Christian is to know Jesus, because Jesus is the only way that you know God. That's why Jesus said what he did in John chapter 14, verse 6. He said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father. No one knows the Father. No one understands the Father except through me." That's why the Nativity. To fulfill Old Testament prophecy and to show us the Father. The third answer to the question why Jesus became a man was to save us from our sins. To save us from our sins. The Apostle Paul states it this way in 1 Timothy. "The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance." In other words, Paul says, you need to buy into this. "That Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of who I am the foremost." Now, you may not want to hear this during this most wonderful time of the year, but you're a sinner in need of a Savior. Why? Because we've all got a sin nature. So Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Our sin nature is the stubborn, self-centered attitude that says, my way or the highway. That sin nature is about self, pleasing self, promoting self, preserving self. Sin is selfish. You were born with that sin nature. We all were. You see, your parents didn't teach you to throw temper tantrums. You were born with that skill. No one showed you how to steal a cookie from your sibling. You just knew how to do that. You didn't need a class on pointing the finger or passing the blame, but you could do it before you were out of diapers. You see, the heart of the human problem is the problem of the human heart. Each of us has entered this world with a sin nature, but God entered the world to take it away. Friends, Christmas commemorates the day and the way God saved us from ourselves through the gift of his Son, Jesus. Listen carefully to the words the angel spoke to Joseph. Matthew chapter 1, beginning of verse 20. "Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit." And then here's key to what he said. "She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will" what? "He will save his people" from their what? "From their sins." Now, at first glance, we don't see the connection between the name Jesus and the phrase "save his people from their sins." But Joseph would have clearly understood the connection. You see, he was familiar with the Hebrew language, and he knew that this name Jesus traces its origin to the Hebrew word Yeshua, which is a shortening of Yehoshua, which means Yahweh saves. Yahweh saves. So who was Jesus? God saves. What did Jesus come to do? God saves. Jesus was not just God-like, God-hungry, God-focused, or God-worshipping. He was God saves. He was not merely a servant of God, an instrument of God, or a friend of God. He was God saves. It's God saves, not God empathizes, cares, listens, helps, assists, applauds. No, Jesus is God saves. God saves. That's the amazing reality of Christmas. You and I need a Savior. And because of Bethlehem, we have one. We have one. Jesus came to save us, not from politics, not from our enemies, not from challenges, not from difficulties. He came to save us from our sins, and he offers salvation to all who will come. If Christ had not come, the course of humanity would be one long, downward, hopeless trudge toward the eternal night of despair. But Almighty God interrupted all of that. He shut down the cycle of sin by sending Jesus to be our Savior. God saves. That's why the Nativity. A final reason why Jesus came as a man was to sympathize with our weaknesses. Speaking about this Jesus, the writer of Hebrews puts it this way. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to what? To sympathize with our weaknesses. But one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Do you know why you can go to Jesus with whatever is going on in your life and know that he hears you and understands you? Because he came down here to experience everything that you've experienced apart from sin. Why did God go so far as to send his only son? One of the main reasons is that he wants you to know that he gets you. If you remember nothing else this Christmas, with all the highs and all the lows and all the grand celebrations and all the difficulties that sometimes come with this season, I want you to remember the reason Jesus came is because he gets you. He understands those highs. He understands those lows. He's been there. He's done that. He gets you. He understands how you feel and has faced what you faced. Jesus is not out of touch with your reality. He's very in touch with your reality. That's why he came. In his book, This is Christianity, author and pastor Maxie Dunham tells an amazing and true story of a plastic surgeon who learned of a man who'd been severely burned attempting to save his parents from a terrible fire. Tragically, the man's parents died in the fire, and the man was burned over a great part of his body with his face badly disfigured. The man mistakenly believed what had happened to him was some sort of punishment from God for not having gotten his parents out safely. And so in his anguish, he refused to let anyone see him, including his wife. So the man's wife went to see this plastic surgeon for help. And after hearing this tragic story, the plastic surgeon said to the wife, "You tell your husband to come see me, because I can help him." But she knew her husband would turn down any offer of plastic surgery because he had his thinking so screwed up. So not knowing what to do, she visited the surgeon a second time. And of course, she was curious as to why he'd come, and so he asked her that. And shockingly, she said, "I want you to disfigure my face so that I can be like my husband. If I can share in his pain, then maybe he'll let me back into his life." The plastic surgeon had never heard anything like that in his many years of practice. He'd always been paid to help people look better. She wanted him to make her look bad, like her husband did. But of course he wouldn't do it. But he decided to go tell her husband what she said. And so he knocked on the man's door and said loudly, "I'm a plastic surgeon, and I want you to know that I can help you." I can restore your face. At first, there was no response. Please come out, the surgeon pleaded. Again, no answer. And still speaking through the door, the doctor told the man of his wife's proposal. Listen, sir, she wants me to disfigure her face to make her face like yours in the hope that you will let her back into your life. That's how much she loves you. There was a brief moment of silence, and then ever so slowly, the doorknob began to turn. Friends, the way that woman felt about her husband is the way God feels about you and me. He took on our face and our disfigurement. He became a man so that God would become touchable, approachable, and reachable. He is Emmanuel, God with us. And whatever you've been through, whatever you're going through right now, whatever you're going to go through in the future, you can be sure that God has been all the way to the end of that road. All the way to the end of that road. Charlie was 10. School was out for Christmas, and the family had chosen to spend the holidays in the country. The boy pressed his nose against the bay window of the vacation home and marveled at the British winter they were experiencing. He was happy to trade the blackened streets of London for the cotton-white freshness of the snow-covered country hills. His mom invited him to go for a drive, and he quickly accepted. As it began to snow, they snaked the car down a twisty road, the tires crunching the snow as they went, and the boy puffed his breath on the window. He was having the time of his life. The mother, however, was a bit anxious. She could tell that this was more than a normal storm. Heavy snowfall came down. Visibility lessened. And as she took a curve, the car started to slide, and it didn't stop until it was in the ditch. She tried to drive out of the ditch, but she couldn't do it. Little Charlie pushed. She pressed the gas, but they were just digging themselves in deeper. They were really stuck, and they needed help. About a mile down the road, there was a farmhouse. So off they went and knocked on the door. Well, of course, the homeowner said, of course you can come in. Please come in and warm yourself and use my phone to call for help. She offered them tea and cookies and urged them to stay until help arrived. An ordinary event? Don't suggest that to the woman who opened the door. She never forgot that day. In fact, she retold that story 1,000 times. And who could blame her? It's not often that royalty appears on your porch. For the two travelers stranded by the English winter were none other than Queen Elizabeth and the heir to her throne, 10-year-old Charles. I wouldn't forget that day, would you? But I want to tell you something far more wonderful than that has happened. The message of Christmas is that royalty has walked down our streets. Heaven's Prince of Peace has knocked on our door. God has moved into the neighborhood. He is one of us. Almighty God is here, and he has you on his heart today. We do not serve a God who is far away. We serve a God who is close at hand, for he has come to be with us. He is our Savior. The Christ of Christmas is here. That's why the Nativity. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the gift of sending your Son, the Son of God, in the form of a human being so that he could fulfill prophecy, so that he could show us who you are, so that he could save us from our sins and sympathize with our weaknesses. May those truths grip us this holiday season. Beyond the lights, beyond the presents, beyond the festivities, may we grab hold of the truth of the why of the Nativity. You sent your Son for us. Royalty arrived and changed the course of human history. May our lives be ever changed because of that truth. In Jesus' name, amen.
like to invite you to stand as you're able and worship with us one more time.
He rules the world with truth and grace and makes the nations prove.
Share a few highlights with you, and then just in a couple of moments we're going to get an update from the lead pastor calling committee this morning. But first off, I hope the showing of the intro to the movie Why the Nativity not only was helpful for the message but entices you to come Wednesday night 6:30 here in the auditorium. We're going to see the whole thing. I've watched it now several times. You want to be here. You want to see this. It's an absolutely cool film presentation about the Nativity. So come join us this Wednesday night at 6:30. Now, just prior to that, starting at 5:30, will be our first Wednesday of the month family meal in the cafe. I'd love to have you come be part of that and then stay for the film or send your kids to children or student ministries. And like we always do, we want to really, really push that you would RSVP for the family meal. And remember, there's three ways you can do that. You can go out to the Connect Center, hard copy. You still like to write your name on a piece of paper, that's one way to do that. If you go to the website, there's an opportunity to RSVP. Or do you see that QR code in the chair in front of you? You could put your camera on it right now, and you can RSVP for the family meal this coming Wednesday. And don't forget, our tradition this fall is we're giving away a gift card after we draw out the names of those who have RSVP'd. So you got to RSVP, and you got to be there if you want to get the gift card. So come join us on Wednesday night. Just want to remind you, too, about the card that you find near you on your seat. It's got all kinds of important dates and times on it. Christmas Eve, 3, 4:30, 10 o'clock. And then we'll gather again the next day, Christmas Day, because it's a Sunday this year, at 9 o'clock for one service. So mark those on your calendar. And then, just a reminder that today, following second service, we're having a Deck the Halls party. We got all the stuff out of the rafters. You see this over here? This is a tree that needs to be assembled and decorated. There's trees out in the commons areas that need to be plugged in and have ornaments hanging on them. There's the big wreath that needs to go up, and we need your help. We know that you would love to help the staff get this place decorated. So right after second service in the cafe, we've got sandwiches, light refreshments, and then we're going to tackle the decoration of the Woodcrest Church for Christmas. Your family can take a tree or take a wreath or do whatever you want. We're going to have a lot of fun, and we'll decorate together. And then next Sunday night, our Starry Night Family Christmas event become a great tradition here. There's going to be a chicken dinner and then all kinds of fun activities and games and Christmas bingo. Those were the gifts I was buying at Target yesterday, is the gifts for Christmas bingo. So next Sunday night, you're going to want to be here. Then we're going to gather in the auditorium for some Christmas caroling. And I've got a brand new Christmas story that I'm going to read for the kids. So I hope that you'll mark that on your calendar. Well, at this point, do I see Chris Thomas? Here he is. Chris Thomas, one of our lead pastor calling committee members, is here to give an update about what's happening. Thanks, Chris.
Thank you, Pastor Pete. I'm Chris Thomas. I have the privilege of serving on the lead pastor calling committee. And just wanted to give you a few quick updates. As you know, we've used Converge organization for the search for our new pastor, and that posting closes on December the 12th. So we've also posted the position with several churches, local seminaries, and colleges. And After that posting closes December the 12th, I think we'll have candidates within 5 to 6 weeks. So sometime in January, we should have a list of candidates from them. At this point, we've had some interested candidates reach out directly to the church or the board or through the website, which we have the job posting on the website you can check out as well. But we've sent them to Converge because we're, you know, trusting in that process, trusting God to work there. And so we haven't really accepted any applications at this point, you know, directly to the committee or through the board. So let's see what else. Yeah, you can check out the website. They did put a banner. I checked it out yesterday, actually, so the posting is there. So it pops up right on the mobile and the on the computer. So, yeah, I think that's about it. And the prayer guide, too. So I want to remind you, too, about the prayer guide that's in the Gather Center for the committee and for the process. So Pastor Pete, I think, made those prayer guides for us. So I think that's about it, Pastor Pete.
Thanks for an update. And again, I just want to really plug, one of the best things we can do as a congregation is be praying. Those 30-day prayer guides are out by the Gather Center. Take advantage of those. Be praying. Really, really important to do that. Let's stand for just a moment. And how about this? You know, we've kind of gotten away from this in the last couple of years, but let's officially take a moment before you leave. Greet somebody. Say Merry Christmas to somebody. Shake a hand. Give a hug. Go have a cup of coffee. We'll see you next Sunday.